In this video, we're looking at the integral of sine pi t on the interval 0 to 2, and we're going to take three different approaches to this integral. So first we have the formal u-substitution. I'm going to give that one star because it's a pretty good solution. And then we have the chain rule backwards solution. I'm going to give that two stars because I think it's even better. And then finally we have the symmetry argument, and from an applied mathematics perspective, this is the best solution because it allows you to skip all the work. So let's take a look now at the formal u-substitution method. I start by saying let u equal pi t, the argument of the sine function there. And then I find the differential of that. And then I prepare myself to transform my original differential of dt. And I'm going to go ahead and transform the limits of integration as well. So if I plug in t equals 0, I can see from my original substitution that u is equal to 0 as well. And when t is 2, u is equal to 2 pi. So this transforms to the integral from 0 to 2 pi. Sine of pi t is now the sine of u. And then dt is du over pi. So I'll go ahead and write the 1 over pi out in front. Now I just have to guess the antiderivative of the sine function. And that's the negative of the cosine function. And I evaluate that on 0 to 2 pi. I'm going to go ahead and factor out the negative 1 over pi as I do this. And I get the cosine of 2 pi minus the cosine of 0. And then I realize, oh, the cosine of 2 pi is 1, and the cosine of 0 is 1. So this is 1 minus 1, which gives me 0. Okay, level 2. Let's try to use the chain rule backwards in a less formal way. So the idea behind this is that when I see something like the sine of pi t, I think to myself, well, maybe that came from differentiating something like the cosine of pi t. But there's a complication, because when I differentiate the cosine of pi t, that would give me negative sine pi t. That's the derivative with respect to the cosine function. And then the chain rule would say, now you have to multiply by the derivative of pi t, which is pi. So I essentially guessed the thing that I differentiate to get sine pi t, but I missed by a factor of negative pi. So all I'm going to do to informally use the chain rule backwards is manipulate the integral by supplying the needed constants into the integrand. So I need a negative pi sine pi t in order to have something that's nicely guessable for the antiderivative. And of course, I can't just throw a factor of negative pi inside this thing. I have to compensate out in front with a factor of negative 1 over pi. And now my antiderivative is easily guessable. The thing I differentiate to get negative pi sine pi t is just cosine pi t. And again, leaving the 1 over pi factored out in front, I get the cosine of 2 pi minus the cosine of 0. And again, that's 1 minus 1, and my integral vanishes. Now, the reason I said this is a better solution is because when you get more practice, just thinking about the chain rule backwards and manipulating the constants in these things, it can make integration very efficient compared to a formal u-substitution. And when you start applying this to other subjects like differential equations, you're doing so many integrals all the time that you don't want every one of them to be a huge ordeal with a u-substitution. Okay, but what about that best argument? So it happens all the time in applied mathematics and physics, where you find yourself confronted with having to take many, many integrals. And fortunately, a pretty large fraction of those integrals vanish. And there's a variety of different arguments for showing that. I just noticed that I got zero on this integral in two different ways. And there's usually an underlying reason for that that's geometric. So let's take a look at the graph of this function. There's the sine of pi t. I notice immediately this thing has a period of 2 pi divided by the coefficient of t, so a period of 2. And I happen to be integrating on exactly one period of a sine function. And so what happens if I integrate on a whole number of periods of a sine or a cosine? I can see from the graph I spend exactly as much time above the t-axis as I do below. And so I can argue that the integral from 0 to 2 of sine pi t dt vanishes because I'm integrating on a whole number of periods of a sine function. Now, of course, it's critical that the midline of this sine function should be the t-axis in order for this to work. But in practice, what you would do to save time in the context of a larger problem is split off integrals that look just like this, sines and cosines integrated on a whole number of periods. All of those vanish, so you don't have to worry about them. So I think that's the best method because it's the most efficient and the most practical. Of course, you don't want to do this in first or second semester calculus because your teacher is probably expecting you to show some work like a formal u-substitution or at least setting up the chain rule backwards. But once you start applying calculus to a more advanced subject, this kind of symmetry argument is considered the superior approach to the problem. Okay, so that's it on the integral of sine pi t, and I hope I've inspired some of you to start looking for these symmetries on your next calculus exam. If you find the math content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce dozens of new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.